Well, a bit into trade this morning, it's looking stable around the 10,000 mark for the index. We're still keeping to our levels there, but it's a quiet start to the trading day. And, you know, we haven't really seen exaggerated moves in stocks just as yet. But Manish Sonthalia, who's a Senior Vice President and Head Equity Portfolio Management Services at Motilal, Oswal Asset Management PMS, joins in with his perspective in the markets. Manish, it's great to have you on the show. Thanks very much for joining us. Business is doing well, I believe, growing at a very fast rate. And we can, you know, substantiate that with the monthly numbers on the inflows for mutual funds, and I would imagine that that extends out to the PMS, portfolio management services industry too, or that segment. But what are market participants making of the potential upside for the markets from here? Because unless we take two steps back, we can't leap forward, and it seems like the market at 10,000 can at best be in consolidation mode.
Yeah, so, you know, it has been a story about flows only, and this has been the case over the last month and a half. We've seen the markets between 9,500 and 10,200 on the upside. I think all rests with what happens to the earnings season that we have just begun, because we are looking at a very low base of last year, so that's going to be aiding growth, and we have the festival season which has arrived a bit early. Combination of both these things, we hope to see numbers better than what the markets would be wanting to see, and that is how the markets can only move forward. If this quarter numbers were to disappoint, then I think that would be a big disappointment for the markets. Least to say, the markets is in a consolidation mode, you know, unless and until something changes, except for the flows. You know, we have seen record flows, but in spite of that, the markets have really not broken out of 10,200 and beyond. So numbers have to support, and that's the only hope that we have going into the earnings season.
Aren't you being a little more hopeful here, Manish, considering the market is going in with extremely muted expectations from the Q2 earnings? Where do you think that ray of hope or glimmer actually lies when it comes to sectoral earnings?
Yeah, so, you know, the whole thing is that this will be the first quarter when we'll see the full-blown impact of GST come through. Nobody really has a handle on how the things are going to play out. You know, corporates are saying different mixed things. Some say, and I'm talking about consumer-facing businesses, some say that business has been very good from the July to September quarter. Some say it has not been so good. So then we have the netting of excise that is going to happen at the top-line level. You know, and costs getting rationalized, savings on account of logistics in the GST regime. Of course, all these things will be playing out to begin with in this quarter, and then, you know, trends would be determined as we move into the third quarter and the fourth quarter. So, you know, this is going to be a trend setter, if not for FY18, then definitely for FY19. And I'm more focused on consumer facing businesses. We understand that, you know, private sector banks would be growing the usual bit, and, you know, the commodity stocks, because of, you know, comparison on a YY basis. Those numbers are all there, you know, for everybody to see. I don't see too much of upside because of positive surprises from that front. I think consumer facing businesses, because of the festival season, the demand that we have seen, and the cost getting rationalized, some pricing power in some of the businesses, there is where the positiveness could come in through. I mean, we'll have to wait for the numbers. It's going to be you know, individual companies that will determine the you know, direction.
Would that be the case that this quarter will capture the entire transition of GST? Because I'd reckon that, you know, since July was the implementation phase, that a large part of this quarter would also give a hazy picture for GST. So perhaps clarity can only come in into the fourth quarter of FY18, not even the third, or perhaps third, because, you know, you have the festive season demand there.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, the whole thing is the commentaries of the management as to how they are seeing their own businesses play out in the GST regime. You know, we are already seeing corporates talking about shutting down of warehouses across the length and breadth of the country, rationalization of logistics costs. I mean, that is an important commentary that would be watched out for, because that would mean a savings of 1-2% on your top line, you know, and we are talking about consumer facing businesses. I mean, that's going to be a huge impact, positive impact, if that sort of a cost gets rationalized across consumer facing businesses. I mean, that could tell you what the numbers are going to look like as we proceed to the fourth quarter and beyond. Of course, you know, the current quarter is going to be a hazy quarter because it was all about, you know, rollout of the GST. But you know, you still have a sense for the first 2 months as to how the direction is going to play out, what sort of an unorganized to organized shift might happen. I mean, though, all those things are definitely not there in the price, both on the positive side as well as on the negative side, how the business will play out. And then you have a tailwind in the form of festive demand coming through, and that's going to be seen as to how you know, companies have fared in terms of top line numbers.
So if indeed, Manish, there are any negative shocks coming in the second quarter numbers, do you think the markets would punish those earnings a little harder than usual, because the expectation is in any case so muted, so any falter thereby would be punished even more?
So, you know, we have the cushion of flows, and flows are just overwhelming, so to speak. And people are waiting to buy the dips and wait for a bit longer, you know. But do you feel comfortable in this sort of an environment where everything gets, you know, washed out, you know, and buying on dips happen just because the numbers have not come? It's all about postponement of numbers from now FY19 to maybe FY20 and 21. So of course there will be negative shock, but I think all those negative shocks are also likely to get bought into, because the overall picture, top-down picture, looks good from the next 2 to 3 years perspective, and flows are overwhelming, so people will buy into these names.
How have you sized up the IPO market, Manish, with the kind of paper that's coming into the markets and the pricing at which new entrants are making their debut? And where is the bias? Because, you know, you on the one hand, you have a lot of insurance companies which are hitting the market, but you're not seeing those listing pops there. Many are touting it, those new issuances, to be long-term structural story, and understandably so. And then you have the consumer, the niche tech companies, which are coming in with those big listing pops, and, you know, drawing a lot of interest from all classes of investors.
So yes, you know, there's a lot of paper that is coming in the markets, and rightfully so, because, you know, flows have been very good. And we're talking about insurance companies, the size of the IPOs are big, and insurance plays a really, really long-term stories, you know. So, you know, they are not likely to get the interest that one would see with small mid-cap companies, because the really long gestation period. And that is not to say that the numbers are not good or the growth is not good, but they are more or less priced to perfection when they come to the IPO market. And really, one really has to wait for the growth to play out in FY19, 2021 for anybody to see some significant upside from these levels, because insurance plays a really long-term story. There is nothing extraordinary that is going to come as a negative shock or a positive surprise when you look at 1 or 2 years perspective. It is all about how you look at the valuations, whether you're comfortable with the valuation when they're coming out with the IPOs, and they are more or less fully priced, you know, when they come with the IPO. There's nothing left on the table for investors. Coming to consumer facing names, I mean, it's all over the place. I mean, the valuations that these companies are coming, I mean, I don't understand how, you know, investors are going to make money, you know, buying into these names at these prices. It's really, really very euphoric, and I don't think that there's any money to be made considering the next 2 years. First the IPO price itself, and then the listing pop that happens, and the entire story for the next 2 years gets over on the first day and the first tick on the price.
Yeah, we're almost getting a deja vu. Can pick up just so many names which actually fall into that category. Manish, just wanted to get your sense also on the underlying demand also that you're seeing in some of the individual sectors. You can see that in the auto sales numbers that have come by. A surprise one like Ashobha Developers, wherein they said that their second quarter pre-sales have actually been the strongest in about almost 10 months. Are you bullish on some of these sectors, auto autos, real estate, which are seeing some signs of a revival. Auto, of course, has been a very strong one.
You know, standout names would be there in the real estate space, particularly those who are focused on the affordable housing and are able to execute. You named Shobha, but this has not been an account of new launches which they have done. It's all about execution of the existing projects. I mean, that is where the sales is commendable. You know, if you launch a new project and you get the sales, I mean, there's nothing very extraordinary that you're going to do. You're going to compete on the price. But you're seeing sales happening from existing launches, and it's more of a case of sales realization, which is seeing an uptick. This is not the case across the board. And these guys are also focused on the affordable housing segment. So one needs to, I mean, I'm bullish on the affordable housing, the lease rental markets, the REITs, I mean, the real estate space. You know, these are the areas where I would be focusing on. And this is a sector which has been long forgotten, so there could be an opportunity in this space, definitely. Coming to auto numbers, I think it's all about two-wheelers because rains have been good. You know, you have the festival season picking up, and it's a low-ticket item as compared to passenger cars and a very low base effect. So I think industry on the two-wheeler space will grow at around 8-9%, and within those specific companies, in any case, you know, does well during the festive season. So I'll be more focused on the two-wheelers and the four-wheelers. But yes, autos, I mean, it's an evergreen story, so nothing to complain about the auto pack as a whole.
Right. Manish, what about IT and pharma? Standard question. Do you be contrarian there, or do you, you know, go with the tide where, you know, it's very differentiated, it's very case specific?
No, so I am a contrarian. Both the IT and the pharma names I have been for the last 6-9 months, and I would continue to remain so. You know, individual companies does have tremendous value at these prices. So, you know, looking into the next 1-2 years with some comfort zone, with some comfort in the prices, I think IT and pharma across the board, you have those getting exhibited. So, you know, there is valuation comfort, and valuations in the market are really very high from a short term perspective. So from that point, yeah, I am contrarian in IT and pharma, you know, both in the large cap space as well as the mid cap space.
Hey Manish, we could go on chatting markets with you as always, but let you go on that note. Thanks as always for joining in.
Thank you.
That's the view then from Manish Sonthalia from Motilal Oswal Asset Management PMS. What's with the market then? And it continues to be a quiet day for the index, but that by no means should be an indicator for individual stocks, because look at MCC, that's holding up by about almost 4%, 10,026 in the Nifty futures. JSW Energy is looking good by about 3.5%.